I have a little essay called 5 a.m. Writing as Ritual. And it has to do with the fact that at some point I felt the need to declare myself a writer. That didn't mean that I would give up everything and go lead the bohemian life. It meant that I understood that you actually have to imagine yourself as an artist before you can become an artist. And the way that I did it was getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning and writing for 2 hours every day before everyone else woke up. I know that that doesn't sound appealing to people, but the point of the story is that you have to allocate a place and time to become an artist. Just like if you want to be the best basketball player that ever existed, you can't sit in a room and say, I am going to be the greatest. You have to get out there to the court and practice and practice. A musician has to practice. A singer has to sing. A writer has to practice writing. And so incorporating writing into your schedule is the very first act in becoming a writer. There is no such thing as a boring subject, only a writer who is bored with the subject. I said, I know because I've read, you know, books on golf, for example, or chess, you know, and it's always the human element involved in activities that don't necessarily interest me. Basically, I tell my students, look at this assignment and then look at ways that you can make it yours. One of the assignments that I have given them to challenge them to come up with something very interesting to say about an object that they have never thought about is to actually think about something that they have seen in their homes. One of the things that can turn something really boring is mawkishness, which is a word I love and rarely get to use. It just means getting sentimental over something. I said it's better to write about a doorstop. What if at your house someone was using an old trophy as a doorstop? What does that mean? Why a doorstop? You know, why was it used that way? Who did it belong to? What history did it bring forward? Or on the other hand, is there a dish in the kitchen that is cracked and no longer attractive, but your mother brings it out every Thanksgiving? I know there is one at my house. My husband is the cook, and he always brings out this dish that belonged to his grandmother. It's stained from years of use, and you can hardly tell the flowers decorating it, but when he puts it on the table, it means it's Thanksgiving. And so if I were to give him the assignment, I would say, first of all, don't get sentimental. Let's start out, where was this dish bought? If nobody knows in the family, then imagine it. And write 10 things down about this object, and then turn that into a story, you know, either beginning with, because the story is not always interesting if you begin at the beginning. You could begin with, I set down the dish on the table. It is Thanksgiving 2010. In Thanksgiving 1960, I saw it at its full beauty in the center of the table at my grandmother's house. Another assignment that I give them in order to infuse their stories with the living voice is for them to go to a restaurant, coffee house, or some kind of public venue in town and to observe people at another table and to imagine what is the situation there. Is there a couple? Are they sitting far apart or close together? Is the woman looking away? Is the man looking away? You know, how do they respond to each other? And without knowing anything about them, or by just listening to snippets of what they're saying, you know, try to create a story, because that is the role of imagination. For me, imagination may begin in a real situation, but enhanced by something that strikes you as a trigger. So they learn dialogue and they learn setting a scene by actually direct observation. And you have to be polite and that's there. But you have to sit close enough so that maybe you can hear something like, no, we're not going to your parents' house again this Christmas. And just begin with that. Okay. The third story my students sometimes will call gross, because I say they have to write a story based on hair or teeth. And some of the stories I get are really, really unusual. I've gotten many versions of the hair story over the years, but the one that I remember the most is a young man who moved from his family home to a dorm and had to deal with a hairy roommate who was not like a model housekeeper. And so every time he came into the room, he said he found things like hairballs, you know, in the bathroom. And this, he was prepared to dislike this roommate because he was not used to having to pick up after other people, especially hair. And this person was from a completely different background than he was. And the point of the story was, it was a hilarious story of all the ways that he had to deal with this unusual situation. But it ended up being a beautiful story about friendship, how these two people came together in spite of the fact that they had different habits and were from completely different backgrounds. And so that is when a journal entry or a funny anecdote turns into art, is when you take something like, I had a hairy roommate, and it becomes, and friendship developed out of the unlikeliest situation of all. Writing is very hard. It's not easy because I don't think that anyone who attempts to excel at anything from sports to music to the arts considers what they do easy. It may look easy, but it looks easy after many, many years of practice. So writing doesn't come easy to me. I don't do it because it comes easy to me. I do it because it is a challenge. For me, the satisfaction of writing comes after I have worked on something long enough that I feel it's good enough to share with others. But for me, revision is actually an act of discovery. I may have like an interesting idea and I'll put it down. And sometimes my poems that end up 20 lines long are usually 10 pages of exploring an idea. And then I become what Michelangelo said, the statue is in the stone. I just chip away until I find it. And that's my theory of working too, is that, you know, we usually have all this information on a subject, but making it art, making especially poetry, is to get the best words down on the paper. And so I feel that the process of discovery and revision is turning to the page and saying, this works, that doesn't, and being brave enough to get rid of the parts that don't work until you have found the statue that is in the stone.
Your real life experience.
I really feel that empathy is an absolutely essential tool for the writer, because if you cannot project into the other lives and other places, then how can your work sound authentic? And so when I am creating a character, for example, I first of all look into myself and see, no matter how different the character is, whether it's a boy who's 14 years old or an old lady, we all share certain basic needs and emotions. We all experience birth and death, joy and sorrow. So I know that however I choose to represent those emotions, they have to be true to the reality of those emotions. Imagination is a uniquely human capacity to envision something that hasn't happened, may never happen, but could happen. And so the way that I do it is, if I'm working on something that is fiction, then I may start with an emotion that I understand, even with a model for a person, that a character who may be a combination of other people I know and myself, but then I imagine them in another situation. I use everything at my disposal to make sure that I'm not always writing me. You know, yes, you should write what you know, but unless you write about what you don't know, then you'll never understand the full realm, you know, that infinite variety that Shakespeare said exists out there.